So, welcome everybody. I am Tatiana Bazzichelli, the director of the Disruption Network Lab, and I'm really happy to announce the second event that we are organizing under the title Cyborg, Hacktivist, Freaks, and Hybrid Uprising. And first of all, I feel to thank my great collaborators, Daniela Silvestrin, that has been also the curator with me for this event, and Kim Foss, that is also our great producer. So we are the team of the Disruption Network Lab, and also Elisabeth for the technical equipment, the technical work, and our great video team, the Rosso Film. And now I would like to start a bit with, first of all, telling what we do with the Disruption Network Lab for the people that don't know. We are a program that is funded by the Abstadt Kulturfonds Berlin, and we have as main cooperator the Kunstrand Kreuzberg Bethanien. And we have been planning six events. The first one was already happening in April. This is the second one, and we will have other events until December 2015. The next one will be in August 8th. And especially for these events, we have a great group of collaborators and also partners that I would like to mention, and then we enter into the hardcore contents. We are also supported for these specific events by the Italian Culture Institute of Berlin, and we have a collaboration with the IBIT Publishing Lab, the Center for Digital Culture of the Leuphana University of Lüneburg, Maison Press, Vierte Welt Collaborationen, and the Axioma Institute for Contemporary Art Ljubljana. And to say that, I would like to enter into the core of our events, and I want to repeat the title that is hacker cyber fem sorry is hacktivist freaks and hybrid uprising, and the people that we are trying to bring together in these events, and also that we have been somehow inviting to be with us are hackers, cyber feminists, transgender activists, and artists. And it's important to say that we have been inspired in creating these events by the English publication of the book The Cyborg from Antonio Caronia. The Cyborg has, in the English edition, the subtitle A Treatise of the Artificial Man. And Antonio Caronia was a political activist that died recently in 2013. And he has been really an important figure in the development of the Italian counterculture, and also the relationship between science, technology, identity, and cultural imagination. And thanks also to the relationship with the Leuphana University of Lüneburg, we managed to translate his book into English. And sorry, I'm also a bit touched by presenting that, because Antonio was a friend of all of us, and so for me to organize this event is something that I find pretty close to my personal life, also my background, and I think is also the background of many other people that are with us in these days. Because we have to say that we all knew Antonio before, and that is also why we decide to contribute in making his thoughts still alive through our practices. And I think it's also important to say that this event is inspired by the book The Cyborg, that actually you can also buy at the counter at the entrance, but it's also not only about that. It's about also people that are embracing the challenge to generate new activist, artist, and hacker interventions. So we start with the reflection on the cyborg, but we try to go beyond also because we think that we speak about that, we have necessarily to speak also about our body, our relationship, the way we interpret technology, the way we use it, and also the way we consciously speak about that, and we try to make it as part of our everyday life. And I just want to tell you some words about the cyborg, and Then we will have an introduction from Franco Berardi Bifo, that unfortunately is not with us, but we really thought that he needed to be with us because he was also a collaborator and a friend of Antonio Caronia, and also a person that we have been working since long together. So we have a video contribute from him. But something that I find really important to say is that if you will read the book of Antonio Caronia, The Cyborg, you will see that for him, the cyborg is a field of social conflict. And is not merely a discussion about the interference between man and machine. So he's not only concerned by that, but is a methodology of cultural criticism. And is also a reflection on individual identity and the concept of multiple bodies. And it's really important to say that this book has been basically written between 1985 and 2008. So Antonio actually published the first edition in 1995, and then in the course of these almost 30 years, he was republishing the book by adding a chapter. And this is important to say because if you consider what happened in the field of media and digital culture between the 80s and the 2000s, then of course you know that many transformations had happened. And so each chapter of the book is basically telling us about this transformation. And the last chapter is also about genetic modification and the criticism of transhumanism. And that is why we are starting these events by having various talks and panels related with the methodology of cultural criticism, the identity construction, also the interference and playful intervention that you could create through technology. But then tomorrow we will go on with a reflection on cyberfeminism and also a great panel about the transhumanist and the criticism of that. And we also want to finish by creating a live cinema related to the discourse of political cyberpunk in Italy, because that was an important part that then we will discuss later today. And so I just want to say that since this book has been an inspiration for all of us, we also wanted to have in these events many Italians, and that is because we want to tell you a bit of a story that was part of our background and also part of our emotion. And I would like just to conclude by bringing some questions to you that I think we are going to unfold in the next panels and days. And then I want to introduce the video Franco Berardi. And the question would be, for example, what does a cyborg mean today? Because many people would say cyborg is actually a concept that is pretty dated in the 80s and 90s. So what happened if we bring it back today? Which new configuration and political action and interventions we can imagine? And which new configurations are possible to provoke critical awareness and agency through sexuality, the body, and also technology? And do we still need to speak about a body? Is still necessary to speak about the body to reflect on identity and a certain kind of cultural and technological criticism? So now I would introduce briefly this video. And this video is actually a bit long, is around 25 minutes. So I actually say that, I mean, it's something a bit unusual to start with a video that is a bit long, but we really thought that was the best way to introduce the person of Antonio and also to introduce the events we are creating. And in this specific video, Franco Berardi is presenting the work of Antonio through their personal friendship, but also their political engagement. So it's something that I consider pretty relevant because it's going back also to the Italian movement of the 1977, the Italian cyberpunk, and the current student movements that have been happening in Italy also some years ago. And for the people that don't know who Franco Berardi is, He's a philosopher, a media theorist, and also an activist. Was the co-founder of Radio Alice and was involved in the radical left movement at the end of the 70s, especially as part of the Metropolitan Indians. And later in Paris, he worked with the French philosopher Félix Guattari in the field of schizoanalysis, and was also the professor of social history of communication at the Academia of Fine Arts of Brera in Milan. And this is also an experience that he shared with Antonio. So now I will leave you to the video, and after that we will have a 20 minutes break, and then we will have a keynote with Massimo Canevacci, moderated by Francesco Warbear, Macarone Palmieri, and I will come back just to introduce briefly after the break Francesco, and he will introduce Massimo. Thank you very much.
I met Antonio Caronia in a foggy day of Milano in 77. I remember very well that meeting. He was working in the center place of Bandiera Rossa, that used to be the newspaper of the Italian Trotskyists. You know, Italian Trotskyists have never been so important in the political landscape of Italy, but he was not only a Trotskyist. Oh, well, I liked Trotskyists, nothing against, but he was many other things already in that time. I discovered immediately that Caronia was a nice person, was a friend since the beginning, since the first meeting. In that period, he was, in a sort, he was exhausting his militant faith, his militant practice, and was on the brink of the collapse, of the final collapse. But he was already imagining new possible scenarios for the future, and these scenarios were growing in the field of science fiction and new imagination. As you probably know, Caronia has been a translator of American and British writers, and particularly a translator of others like Ballard, Burroughs, and so on. I mean, that brand of science fiction literature that is more keen to the imagination of parallel universes and of new possibility for the humankind. The relation between politics and science fiction was the main subject of Un'ambigua Utopia, an ambiguous utopia, the name of the magazine that Caronia, together with Giuliano Spagnol and some others, was producing at the end of the 70s. I don't remember exactly the dates. You know, if we want to talk about that attention, that kind of discovery of science fiction that happened at the end of the 70s, at the beginning of the 80s, for him, for Antonio Caronia, but also for me and for many other people, was not exactly the same kind of discovery, the same kind of attention, which is which is characteristic of the true science fiction audience. We were discovering science fiction as a sort of marginal imagination as a sort of possibility of imagining something beyond the defeat, the end of the revolutionary imagination of the 20th century. So, in a sense, reading Philip Dick for us was the possibility of imagining the plurality of the universes, was the possibility of imagining that the depressive reality that was coming on the fore at the end of the 70s and in the following years and the following decade, well, that was only one of many, one among many possible universes, and the task of the writer, the task of the artist, not less than the task of the activist, is to explore other possibilities beyond reality. There is a sentence that I remember sharing with Caronia, a sentence by Philip Dick in an interview published maybe at the end of the 80s, an interview with Philip Dick. Philip Dick told that when you dream alone, it's a dream. But if you start to dream with other people, that is no more a dream. That's the beginning of a new possible world, the koinos cosmos, the universe that we can share. This is the way Antonio Caronia invented this possibility of shifting from the activity of politics to the activity of SF imagination, science fiction. Science fiction is a narrow way to define that field of literary imagination. Can you reduce the work of Ballard to the genre of science fiction? It's much more than science fiction. It's a hyper-modern form of social critique, and it's also a sort of new form of political imagination. This is Ballard, this is Philip Dick, and this is what I shared with Antonio Caronia. In the 80s, essentially. Then came the revelation at the end of the 80s. I was in California. I stayed there for some, let's say, since 88 to 90, for in those years, I was much more in California than in Europe. And when I came back, I was totally fanatic of something new that was going to happen in the world and blah, blah, blah. We call it that cyberpunk. Just to have a way to connect our punk relation with the past and our cyber relation to the future. Punk was the decaying, the decomposition, the corruption of the body, of the flesh, of the real world, and cyber was the imagination of a possible visionary hyper-tech form of communication. I organized an international conference in June 1994 in Bologna, and the title of the conference was Cibernauti, And I remember I was there waiting for people to come, and at a certain point I see Caronia. I never called him Antonio, I called him Caronia. Caronia is so, such a nice word, you know, it sounds so well. Antonio is a little bit, it's very Italian, very much Sant'Antonio, lo deserto, si cuoceva i maccheroni, Caronia. So I saw Caronia coming towards me, and he said, Cibernauta Caronia rapporto. And it was, well, I can't forget that that I had been maybe not seeing him for a while, for 2-3 years. And all of a sudden I see Caronia coming to that conference, I felt that his irony, well, I want to say something about the Caronia's irony because it's important, but I felt that his way to smile and to say Cibernauta Caronia rapporto, which is an expression very much military or militant, I'm here, and he did like this, you know, and I felt that he was saying, and only me and you can understand, that the old solidarity, the old political solidarity was still alive. In different, under a different dress, under a different form of imagination, but it was still there. The knowledge that if you are doing something and you need me, I'm there. I share your next dream because it is our common dream. Cibernauti was, in my opinion, was an important moment in the possibility of innovation of Italian culture. But for me, it was important most of all because I met those people like Antonio Caronia. I had the impression that those people who had been with me on the barricades in the 60s, in the 70s, those people, many of them are too old, are out of the world, are bitter and, unable to understand the new, but some of them still are able to feel the beauty of the possible, the beauty of the innovation, the beauty of the surprise, the cultural surprise, the political surprise, the technological surprise, the ability to feel the pleasure of this difficult relation, which is the relation between culture and technology. This was the important link between me and Caronia. At a certain point, he called me on the phone and he told me, "Do you want to come to teach at the Accademia di Brera in Milano?" Caronia was the mind behind the creation of this new Institute of Art and New Media. I went there, I started going to Milano, I started teaching, and I started perceiving a new side of the personality of Antonio Caronia. I already knew the political activist, I already knew the writer and the translator, I already knew the science fiction intellectual, and I already knew his ability in creating cultural campaigns and so on, but I did not know yet the teacher, Don't forget, I tell myself, that Caronia was, first of all, an electronic engineer, a mathematician. He was not a humanist by formation. I've always fallen in love with these kind of activists. I remember some names that you don't know, so I don't tell you. But I tell you one. My best friend in the life, Piero Losardo, who was an electronic engineer and a poet, an electronic engineer and an activist, an electronic engineer and a crazy person, an electronic engineer and the master of all the druggies of the world. And, you know, this is the kind of people that I like, those people who have gone through the world of figures, of algorithms, of things that I totally cannot understand, but they do. They have seen the unseeable. They have, and simultaneously they are able to feel that algorithm is everything and algorithm is nothing. It's formatting our life, but our life has nothing to do with the format. This is the genius. Someone who is simultaneously able to produce the most inhuman tools and is simultaneously able to slide away from the effect, from the systemic effect of the algorithmic chain. Antonio Caronia was that kind of people. We shared some students, of course. Some went to listen to Caronia, then they came to listen to me, and some students told me, oh, you know, Caronia is crazy. Sometimes he stops everything and he writes figures on the blackboard, and he says, this is mathematics, this is poetry, you cannot understand, I don't understand. But, you know, this relation with the beyond, the limit of the human, his way of speaking about post-human, about the cyborg. The idea that Caronia has developed in his, probably in his most known book titled Il Cyborg, The Cyborg, his idea of the cyborg is not a technological idea. And so he knows very well what he's talking about, much better than me, of course. But at the same time, he is able to be absolutely precise about technological stuff, but at the same time he has a sort of ironic smile, like to say, we, the humans, know much more than the truth. We know much more than perfection. We are beyond the truth, beyond perfection, because truth is dangerous. Perfection is dangerous. We need to discover perfection, to produce perfection, but also to go beyond mathematical perfection. I wish that Mr. Schauble and Lady Merkel could understand this, that mathematics is important, you know, but you have to go beyond mathematics if you are human. You have to forget about mathematics if you are human. This is the lesson I learned from Caronia. At the end, the last thing we happened to do together is the occupation of the Borsa of Milano. It was the year 2011, probably the year when we started imagining for a moment that the revolution was back, then the possibility of changing in a radical way the relation between human beings was at hand, the period of Occupy. In the spring of 2011, after seeing what was happening in London, what was happening in the Spanish cities, and what was happening in the Arab world, we decided to do something similar also in the city of Milano, which is an important place for the Italian financial capitalism, not only Italian, of course. We entered the stock exchange and we occupied the space with 100 students, maybe our students. We decided to make a teach-in as in London. In London, many banks, in many financial institutions, students and teachers had organized the teach-ins. And the reason was visible, was easy to understand. The reason was that financial capitalism is robbing our money, the money for education, for public school, for the university. So we don't have any more a place where to teach, and actually the Accademia di Brera is no more a place to teach because it's crumbling, and at the art and the new media, it's difficult to find a computer, well, we decided to go there and to sit down on the pavement. The police arrived and we were thrown away, but I remember Caronia was the main, he had a loudspeaker, and he was starting again a discourse about, I want to explain what financial capitalism is, but the police blocked him, and he started again, I want to explain what financial capitalism is. Some months after, Caronia told me that he was sick. And also his long period of sickness makes part of his mythology, I mean of his way of reacting, of ironically reacting, but at the same time, if I can dare, of heroically reacting to the cancer. Never stopping smoking, if I remember well, and never stopping teaching. When he died, we organized a sort of meeting of the friends. And a girl went to speak to say something about, and she told, I want to say only one thing. Antonio era bellissimo. He was beautiful. Everybody laughed in the room. Oh, you're joking. You're making fun of me. Well, he was beautiful in a sense, because I don't know what beauty is, but if I can say what beauty is, I would say beauty is the ability to be ironic, the ability to do something and shift, and be detached, and be critical and be ironical. First of all, ironical towards yourself. Irony is essentially self-irony. You will never be ironic if you don't understand that being ironic is, first of all, be able to laugh about yourself. His form of defy against death has been going on his work of teaching, of speaking, of ironizing, of imagining, of opening doors on the infinite of possible imaginations. Then he died like this, because everybody, sooner or later, everybody dies. Thank you very much.